Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our morning service here at Saron Chapel Independent Baptist Church. Glad for you to join us with us today. It is a tremendous blessing to be in the house of the Lord, and we are excited about what is getting ready to transpire, not only today, but in the upcoming weeks. Amen. And so thank you again for joining us online here at Saron Chapel. We want to welcome you here today. And just some brief announcements, guys, on the upcoming week and things that are going on and what things may change. Again, going back to our weekday activities for the youth, those are postponed for the present moment. They are postponed until further notice. And our online services this week will be our Tuesday Bible study via Zoom at 1 p.m., as well as our Wednesday Bible studies at 11 and 6 p.m. this week and the following week. Those will continue to be online for an indefinite period of time. Just considering everything that is going on right now, we are not quite sure, we're not 100% positive with what changes we want to revert back to. However, we are reopening our regular services together one with another as of next Sunday, the 26th of July. That will be at 11 a.m. Now, what we are planning on doing in this gradual restart is we're going to come back together at 11 a.m. Only at 11 a.m. We're going to go down to one service on the Sunday at 11 a.m. until we see how things transpire out. We've heard many stories of those that have reopened, and for whatever reason, they've had to shut back again because of COVID spikes and things like that. So right now, we just feel like it's the best thing for us to do here at Saron. And as Preston and I were discussing, he brought up a very good point that it gives you an entire week that if somebody is or becomes symptomatic, we have a seven-day period to find out what happened and to make sure they stay at home and whatnot. And so we're going to take things gradual right now. So reopening is next Sunday, 26th of July, 2020. And our Wednesday Bible studies will be for the rest of July, 11 a.m. and 6 p.m. Virtual. And then as we always do in August, guys, we're going to go back down just to one Bible study on the Wednesday. That's a regular thing that we've done over the past years. And so we'll go to our 6 p.m. Bible study. It will continue to be virtual at the present moment. That will be an evaluation that we make on a weekly basis, and we'll give everybody plenty of time to prepare on when we're coming back on the Wednesdays. Guys, we just feel like this is the best thing that we should do right now. So I know for at least the next 2 weeks, we'll be virtual on Tuesday and on Wednesday, and then 11 a.m. on Sunday morning, we will be live in person as well as online. So for those of you who cannot make the service on Sunday morning, for whatever particular reason, you'll be able to pick it up anytime throughout the day, if you will, online. So what a blessing that is. We're going to ask a blessing upon the day today. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles to Revelation 21 this morning, Revelation 21 for our reading. And once we've opened in prayer, we will go to our reading this morning. So Brother Preston, if you'll be so kind to bless this morning's service, and then I'll read Revelation 21, verses 1 through 5.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be here today. I ask God that you will just move among the service. It's just us two here, but God, I'm asking you to come by and visit with us. And Lord, I pray, God, that we'll be uplifting to you, that we'll show honor and glory unto you. Touch Brother Stagner as he prepares to preach. God, I ask that you'll just use him, help him to preach like he's never preached before, and help us to be attentive, God, as we sit and listen unto your word being taught. And Lord, I ask that you'll touch in the singing time. Help us just to ring out praises unto you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Revelation 21, if you will stand. Brother, is everything okay with the mic? You can hear it? It's coming through fine? All right, because just the speaker went down. I wasn't sure if you went the volume down or not. It's no matter to me. All right, so Revelation 21, stand if you will as we honor the reading of the Word of God. Revelation 21, beginning in verse 1. Revelation 21, beginning in verse 1. The Bible says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, For these words are true and faithful. Surely the reading of the Word of God be a blessing to your heart and your mind here this morning. May put your Bibles down, have a seat if you will, or you can remain standing during our time for hymns. I turn over to Brother Preston for our first hymn of the morning, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Praise the Lord. What a blessing that is this morning. You want to turn me down just a little there, buddy. Thank you so much. Amen. It is a blessing to be here, guys. It is that time we come to give back unto the Lord as He has graciously given unto us. Remember, the Bible says, honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of thine increase. So it's that time for us to come and give as God has graciously given unto us. Make sure we give of our tithe and our offering and our missions, okay? So remember, guys, when we do come back, which will be next Sunday, the 26th, for your tithe and offering, if you're continuing to give online, that is fine. We just ask that you fill one of the tithe and offering slips out, if you will. Place them in the bag as it comes around through this tithe and offering time. We want the date to line up with the date of debit as well as the date that it is given. So it doesn't matter if the date of debit is on a Monday or a Saturday, but the date it was given was on a Sunday. As long as we can reconcile the accounts of which day it was committed here at the church on that Sunday, and make sure you specify what it is for. Remember, our tithe is our start, our offering, and our missions is above and beyond that tithing given. So I'm going to ask the blessing upon the tithing today, and then we'll get into our message here this morning. Father in heaven, we pray, dear God, that you would bless the substances of our increase. We pray that you'd bless all that which is given, Lord. We ask of you today to please help it further the gospel throughout our village, throughout the valley. Father, we pray that as we continue to give, as you've graciously given to us, Lord, let us be mindful, Father, that you have given everything unto us, that it's all yours, Lord, and that we need to come back and give unto you as you have graciously given unto us. And Father, we pray as we continue to support missions, locally here and throughout the country and throughout the world, Father, that you'll allow that mission given, Father, to further the gospel, to be preached throughout the United Kingdom and throughout, again, the world. Father, as we support church planters, Father, back in the States and church planters and men of God throughout India and all other places in the land, Father, and in Europe and just through the United Kingdom, Father, we pray that you bless the funds that are given, but bless those that receive them and help them, dear Lord, reach people for the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and praise your wonderful name. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. Well, I hope and pray that God has been good to you today. Trust that he has. And I'm excited to get into this message today. It is something that's been on my heart for a few weeks now, and God really allowed me to dig in deep this week and get right after it. And it's something, guys, again, here we are in the middle. We're coming at the end of this. Well, I say we're coming at the end of the restrictions for COVID, and we don't know what's going to transpire over the next couple of weeks. I know for 4 months, guys, we've been on some type of restriction. Whether you've been locked down and laid down inside your house and not been able to leave at all, or whether or not you've been able to leave sporadically throughout the last 4 months, either which way about it, our life has met some type of interruption. I'm going to go ahead and say this, make it crystal clear today. It could be much, much worse, and there's a good chance that things in our life do get worse, okay? That's something that we need to understand. I mean, we live in a world today, a society today, that I believe, and I believe most people do, have grown a little soft. You know, there was a time where kids would go out and they would play and they would scruff their knees up and they would ride their bikes and they would do all these different things. They'd come in dirty and sweaty and, you know, with blood on their hands and their elbows and on their knees, and they just were out playing, having a good time. And we live in a world today to where when their iPad is dead, when the battery dies, they get depressed, and now they need to see a doctor, and they feel as if they're traumatized. And I believe there's been a foundation laid for softness in the world today. When something like this comes around, this restriction, people just enter into this panic mode, and they enter into this world to where, you know, they just don't know how to cope with things anymore without their blankie or without a prescription. And I'm not trying to be mean, guys, okay? I'm not trying to be angry. I'm not angry at all, because we're preaching on something greatly positive today. But even in the midst of a snowflake soft world, and even in the midst of a world today that is placed on restrictions for whatever reason, okay? I don't buy into conspiracies and all this and that, but I know there's something else that is going on during this period of time, be it whatever it is. We know that we are under attack in this world today by the dark forces of the devil, and that Bible makes that crystal clear. But guys, we have to learn how to cope with things according to Scripture. And so today I want to bring a thought to you. I want to bring something that, in all fairness, is near to my heart, and I want to talk to you about a play. I want to talk to you about heaven today. I want to speak to you about heaven, something to look forward to. Guys, I understand that we're looking forward to coming back in person next week. I am looking forward to some human interaction. I'm looking forward into seeing people and to talk to real people. And I'm looking forward to the time where I'm not just preaching to a camera. And as much as I've enjoyed the fellowship and the labor that Brother Preston and I have had here in the house of God, we are both looking forward when people can come in and fill the pews. Amen. We're looking forward to that. I think humans were meant to be together. We were meant to not forsake the assemblies of ourselves together, as the Bible commands us in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25. We understand those things. But guys, there is something beyond restrictions. There is something beyond problems in this world. There's something beyond the predicaments and the pain and the suffering that we have to look forward to in this world. And my friend, it's a place called heaven, amen. And the Bible is clear about where heaven is. The Bible is clear about who's going to be in heaven, amen. And we're going to look at that this morning and this evening. I'm excited about this message. I'm greatly excited about it. So guys, I just hope that you buckle in your pew belts today. Open up your Bibles to Revelation 21, where we were for our reading today. And I won't ask you to stand, as we've already stood for the reading of the Word of God during our reading time. But the Bible says in Revelation 21, beginning in verse 1, it says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. There was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. Father in heaven, we pray a special blessing upon the reading of thy word today. And I ask you, dear God, to convey these thoughts, Lord, that you have instilled upon my heart today into the hearers' ears, into their minds, into their souls. Father, we look forward to that day that we may dwell in the heavens. We look forward to that day, that place that is being prepared yet even now for those that believe on the name of Christ. We look forward to that day where we'll be in there, where there'll be no more pain, no crying, no death, nor sorrow, no anguish, no nothing, dear God, we pray. Lord, we look forward to that day, and it is something for us to look forward to. And I ask of you this morning, if there be one person, Lord, watching or listening to this sermon, wherever they may be, that knows you not as Lord and Savior, Father, they have not this place to look forward to. As a matter of fact, the place that they are going to is the worst place that ever to be thought of and created, which was created for the devil and his angels. And I ask of you, dear God, that you would embark upon their heart, their soul, mighty conviction from on high, that they would come to you with open contrition and accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, so they too can have something to look forward to, a place called heaven. In Jesus Christ's name, we ask these things. Amen and amen. Revelation 21 speaks of a place called the new heaven. It speaks of a place called the new earth. And beloved, the world in which lies before us today is incomparable to anything that we have ever in our life seen. I mean, there's very little detailed throughout the entire Bible of what heaven will really be like. As a matter of fact, chapter 21 is the one of its greatest detail in the book of Revelation. Heaven is a place, beloved, that if you are saved and born again, you can look forward to. It's a place, my friend, that is spoken about here in Revelation 21 in great detail. But again, out of all the other places, there's more information in the Bible about hell than there is about heaven. And beloved, national surveys were taken of teens in the United States and Great Britain as well as Canada, and it indicates that approximately half of all teens in these countries believe in life after death. Belief amongst Australian youth is an idiosyncratic and self-directed belief, which few look toward an external authority for guidance in formulating their belief. In other words, they develop their belief from within themselves. You know, in representative of these surveys, it was about approximately 1,000 people were taken. Only 32% of them said they believe in heaven, and only 21% of them say they believe in hell. Why? Because they have developed it from their own mindset, from their own opinions, from their own feelings. Now, we know, guys, in our life, our feelings change. Our mind changes. Our view on certain things sometimes will change. And my friend, heaven has never changed. Everlasting life has never changed. The Lord Jesus Christ has never changed. I mean, he's always been there. And the Bible has never changed, no matter what people do to make it change. The true Word of God has never changed. In our world today, only 9% of young millennials believe in heaven, compared to 11% of older millennials. My own generation, only, which is considered to be Generation X, only 27% believe in heaven, and 37% of the baby boomers believe in heaven. Most religions in our world today, they teach of some place that they call heaven, whether it be nirvana or paradise or even some transitionary disembodied state. They teach on something that is beyond the years and days that we're living here. But the truth of the topic is this, is that the Lord has not left us ignorant about what heaven is. The Lord has not left us to guess about where heaven will be. He has not left us ignorant to the fact that there is a heaven, a place that we call a place that we will call home in eternity. And it's in chapter 21 of the final book of the Bible in Revelation that God gives us eternity, that he speaks of it. It at least gives us a glimpse into the glory of our heavenly abode. And friends, I'm here to say this to you this morning. I believe in all of my heart, it is something to look forward to. It is something to look forward to, my friend. Out of all the tragedies and out of all the problems and out of all the discord and all the death and all the dismay and all of the things that are happening in the world today, There is a place that we will call home. There is a place in eternity called heaven that for every believer, my friend, it's a place to look forward to. The first thing I want you to see here this morning, it will be in verse 1, is that we find something to look forward to that is new. We find a place that is new. In verse 1, the Bible says it's a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth are passed away and there was no more sea. Here we have a new heaven, we have a new earth, and there are doctrinal reasons for both of them. And here's what I'm asking you to do today. Again, I ask you always, search the scriptures to see if they be so. I'm going to teach some things today and preach some things today that you may have never heard before, that you may disagree with, but you need to get into the Bible, get into your AV, and study it out and see if these things be so. We have a new heaven, we have a new earth here in Revelation 21. And again, there are doctrinal reasons for both. But that isn't just it, beloved. There's not just a new heaven and new earth, but the Bible says there's no more sea, and that's important for us to understand. There is something new, and there's something not. There's something new, and there's something that has been there since creation, but now it's gone away. This sea that it is speaking of in Revelation 21 is not talking about the Atlantic or the Indian Oceans or the Pacific Ocean. It's not even close. It's not even what it's referring to. This is the sea of glass that you read about in Revelation 4, verse 6. The Bible says, and before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal in the midst of the throne, and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. It's the same thing spoken of in Job, called the deep. In Job 38:30, the waters are hid as with a stone, and the face of the deep is frozen. The sea like in the glass, it's frozen. This is the very deep where Leviathan, who is Satan, that you read about in the book of Job, that makes a pot of ointment, and it makes it hoary in Job 41. So, beloved, when heaven is rolled back as a scroll, that's where you find there is no more sea. What does that mean? It means there's no more separation between the abode of God and his creation, mankind. In Revelation 6:14, the Bible says, and the heaven departed as a scroll when it rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their place. But there is no more sea when you read about it in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 10, when that is fulfilled. But the day of the Lord, it will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heaven heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with a fervent heat, and the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Beloved, listen, this happens 1,000 years before the new heaven, the new earth, and against what we're going to get to in just a moment, the new Jerusalem, before they ever appear. Before they come on the scene, this sea is done away with. 2 Peter 3:10 is a direct statement to the second coming of Jesus Christ, which ends the tribulation period and begins the millennial kingdom of the 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ on this earth. When Satan is locked away for 1,000 years, that he'll deceive no more until he's turned loose for a little season. That's why, doctrinally speaking, there is a reason why we find in Revelation 21, eventually there's a new earth, and then there's a new heaven, and then in verse 2 we see the new Jerusalems. It's not just new things that aren't just in heaven and in earth. There is a new Jerusalem. Verse 2 says, and I saw the holy city, new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Now we're getting into the good stuff, my friend. Now we're getting into the place that we know is that heavenly abode of believers yet today. And we'll get into that. This is not the Father's bride, as some people have interpreted. God the Father's bride, okay? Now God the Father's bride is Israel. But the New Jerusalem is a city prepared to marry Jesus, who is the Son. Now in Revelation 21, I'm not going to ask you to turn there. We'll look at it later on. But in verses 9 and 10, we find three new elements: New Jerusalem, New Heaven, and New Earth, just like we're finding in verses 1 and 2. And there's a reason that you have that. As a matter of fact, now you start to find out an answer to a Bible verse that you may have read thousands of times and not clearly understood it, okay? The New Jerusalem is said to be the mother of every born-again believer in the church age. Galatians chapter 4 and verse 26 says, But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, okay? Which is the mother of us all. What does that mean today? It means that the new Jerusalem is the dwelling place prepared for the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ, as the marriage supper of the Lamb and the marriage itself has already occurred way back in Revelation 19, verses 7 and 8. So it's not the marriage here. This city coming down is not metaphorical of the bride of Christ, but rather it is the dwelling place. It is the city for the bride of Christ, amen, which is the church of the living God, every born-again believer during the age of Christ, the age of the church age. That's why Paul says in Galatians 4:26, but Jerusalem, which is above. Not Jerusalem that is on this earth. Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. So get this, guys. What is the significance of having three new elements in eternity? Remember, guys, Revelation 21 is speaking of eternity. All right, there's a reason. Now, I want you to stay here with me on this. When we're looking at this place, this heaven, this place to look forward to, something to look forward to. Number one, the new earth we find is for the Jew. The new heaven we find is for the Gentile. But the new Jerusalem is for the Christian, both saved Jew and Gentile. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 32 says, "Give none offense neither to the Jews nor to the Gentiles nor to the church of God." The church of God is made up of both Jew and Gentile who have been saved and born again of the blood of Christ. But beloved, when we get to eternity, the same three branches are found in eternity with separate places of abode and separate places of service. And you say, oh, hang on a second. You mean to tell me that the Jews that are alive today, they're going to be there, and the Gentiles alive today are going to be in the new heaven? No, that's not what I'm saying at all. We're going to get into that. We're going to answer those questions. So don't turn it off yet. I am telling you this, that New Jerusalem is for the Christian. New Jerusalem is for the born-again believer, be it a saved Jew during this age or a saved Gentile. All right, there's only two people on this earth, Jew and Gentile, hands down. If you're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. If you're not a descendant, not only a descendant of Shem, but I mean someone tied to Jacob, one of the 12 tribes, that's what makes you a Jew, okay? Not just a descendant of Shem. Two groups of people, Gentile and Jews, okay? And then the third group is made up of saved Jews, saved Gentile. And that's the church of God, all right? Those same three branches you have are found in eternity, separate places of abode and service. This is the eternal destinations of people in the world. The saved people is New Jerusalem. But you'll look at that new heaven, new earth in just a moment here. And look in verse 3. The Bible says that New Jerusalem has no temple. Okay? The New Jerusalem has no temple. Look in verse 3. The Bible says, "And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." The New Jerusalem has no temple. There may be a tabernacle on the earth for the Jew in eternity, but there is no temple in the New Jerusalem. Look in verse 22 of our same chapter. Verse 22 says, "And I saw no temple therein, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple to it of it." Let me see. The temple of it. So it's clear in the New Jerusalem there's no temple, for the Lord God Almighty is the temple of it. Okay? So we understand that in verse 3. Verses 4 through 6, read this with me if you will. The Bible says, "For God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no death, or no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat upon the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto them, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of water of life freely." First off, guys, I want you to understand that the Bible's clear about who's saying these words, and the Bible's clear about these words that are new, that are being these things that are being spoken of that are new, these three elements. They're true and they're faithful. It's not figurative, it's not allegoric, it's not symbolic, it's not metaphorical. If you have bought into those lies, you have bought into a lie. These are literal words that are true and faithful. They are true and they're faithful, given by Alpha Omega, given by the beginning and the end. So, beloved, just stop for a moment, and I want you to think about what we would not know today if we did not have the book of Revelation. As a matter of fact, our favorite verses that we quote about our heavenly home on high, they come from the book of Revelation. So think about this, those out there today that would like to deny the book of Revelation and say that it's only symbolic, that it's or that it was fulfilled in AD 70. Those are lies, guys. Why? Because this speaks of eternity, amen. This speaks for us for something to look forward to in our world today. Every saved individual born again of the blood of Christ, from the time that they received Jesus Christ after the death, burial, and resurrection, my friend, until the last day on this earth or the rapture of the church, my friend, they will have an abode. They will have a heavenly home called the New Jerusalem. Now, there are those that will be saved, if you will, per se, after the rapture of the church, the tribulation millennial sort. Not the martyrs, but those sort that we'll speak about here. And that's why you have these three elements that are new. It's not just this abode that we're looking forward to. And we are looking forward to being in New Jerusalem. Amen. But you got that new heaven. You got the new earth. And there's a reason for it, guys. So there are three things that we find that are new. But I want you to look at what is next. Look in verse 6 again. Read it with me. The Bible says in verse 6. It says, and he said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is a thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. My friend, check this out here. There is water. There is the water of life to be taken freely. Did you know that the Bible clearly says that this is the first word to ever be misquoted? Sadly, it's not the last, but ever be misquoted in all the Word of God, freely. Genesis chapter 2, verse 16, read it from your screen. The Bible says, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But in Genesis chapter 3, verse 2, watch what happens. And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of every fruit, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. And then, of course, we know where she goes on. She starts adding to the Word of God, but she removed the word freely. The first word ever misquoted in the Bible was freely. So not only did we see Eve add to the Word of God in Genesis 3, but she started out by omitting the Word of God, completely removing the word freely. So what's the result? Well, the tree of life was no longer free. Revelation 22, verse 14 says, blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. You see, beloved, the water of life is free. It's a free gift of salvation. It's during this, and it's for any dispensation. The millennium, by the time we get to Revelation 21, the millennial kingdom has already passed in Revelation 21. So this invitation can be for someone that went through the millennial kingdom. It can be for someone who went through the tribulation, or this can be for someone in the church age, this water of life. Hang on. Revelation 22, verse 17 says, and the spirit of the bride, and the spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth come, say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life, here's the word again, freely. My friend, the bride of Christ invites men, women, and children to come to Christ, which is only true during the church age. The bride of Christ is to invite people to accept Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior, come and take of the water of life freely, and that is only true during the period of time that we are living right now, the church age. But just like we read in Revelation 22, verse 14 a moment ago, we've already read that, only those who keep his commandments after the church age will have right to the tree of life. Now, this is what's true in the millennium and the tribulation. You see, guys, dispensationally, you have to have everything tied together, connected, because you can't have those having right to the tree of life if they do the commandments of God, and those over here can take of it freely, joining together at the same time. That doesn't work. That's called confusion. And that's why so often many people say, well, it's just allegorical. It's just metaphorical. We have a place beyond this world here today that we are going to and we are living in. So where does it leave us dispensationally speaking? We're looking at dispensationally, and we're looking at verse 6 that says right there, and I will give unto him that is a thirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. In that new Jerusalem, where does that leave us dispensationally today? Well, there's an invitation to the souls of the church age where it applies. And we see that in John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14. Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, speaking of that well. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto everlasting life. Odd? Shouldn't be. It's just Bible. Just read your Bible and you'll understand that if you partake into that water of life now that Jesus Christ is offering you as a person in this world today, then you'll never thirst again, spiritually speaking. You have a place in this new Jerusalem that we're speaking of here today. You see, my friend, the Lord Jesus Christ has given John his revelation in Revelation 21. He's revealing to his apostle all of these things, things which have been, things which are, and things that will be. But now he's getting ready to talk about the new Jerusalem, amen? He's talking about the new Jerusalem, the final home of the Christian. And this is what you got to look at it. You got to think about it like this. Jesus Christ, all right, our Savior, the King of Kings, the Ruler of Rulers, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, who spoke all things into creation, who by him all things consist, is revealing to John, okay, on the Isle of Patmos, the future home of every born-again believer during the church age. He's ready to talk about the new Jerusalem, this final home of the Christians, and he is burdened for lost souls. Even though Jesus has given the revelation to John the Apostle here in Revelation 21 about the future home of Christians, he is still burdened about lost souls when he's given this in AD 96. He's still burdened nearly 2,000 years ago. He's burdened about lost souls that he wants them to be in that home. So, beloved, he cannot begin to describe the final resting place without giving an invitation of saying, come on in and get some. He can't do it, my friend. He wants people to be in the new Jerusalem. He knows how scarce it will be for those to make it through into the new heaven and the new earth. Oh, but the new Jerusalem is something new. It's something, my friend, that is next. It is the final home of the saved, the bride of Christ. But that's not it. That's not all that the new Jerusalem is. Look in verse 7. Verse 7 says, he that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. The key word there is overcometh. Now, just like we read in verse 6 that God, the Lord Jesus Christ, has given this invitation to those in the church age for New Jerusalem to be their home, now in verse 7, this is a true statement of those in the tribulation who overcomes. We see that in Revelation 2, chapter 2 and chapter 3, but we also see it in the Christians in 1 John chapter 4:4 and 4:5, which says, First John 4:4 and 1 John 5:4, which says, ye are of God, little children, and overcome them. But greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. He says in chapter 5, verse 4 of the same book, he says, and for whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who overcame the world is Jesus Christ. And when Jesus Christ is inside of you by accepting him as the free pardon of sin, that's where that overcometh comes from. And that's after you've had that water of life freely. But you'll see in verse 8 is one of the saddest words in all of this context. Probably out of all the great things that have been said in the first 7 verses, in verse 8 you see the word but. But is the saddest word in this context. Because herein lies a list of those who will not partake in the New Jerusalem. Notice this, but the fearful and unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. My friend, those that are listed right there are those who will not be in a place that has no more sorrow. Those that are listed in verse 8 right there will not be in a place that has no more pain, that has no more sickness, that has no more bills, has no more death, and all and on and on. They are the condemned. They are eternally condemned from chapter 20, verse 14. But notice what the passage of God, how it classifies the unbelieving with the whoremongers and murderers and liars. Notice that, my friend, that he's classifying those that do not believe with those that we look in the world today and we look down upon them and the sin that they're living in. But unbelieving is just as bad as being a whoremonger, a liar, or being a murderer. If you were to ask the average bloke on the pavement today, what is the worst crime that you can ever commit? And they say, probably taking a life. Murdering someone. But the Lord God looks at someone who does not believe the word of God as being equal with the murderer on the street today. That's true, my friend. He says that they're not going to have part in this new Jerusalem. Verse 9 is pretty clear, I believe, in all of my heart. It says in verse 9 that we find here that the bride is no longer engaged, but he's the wife. And there came unto me one of the 7 angels which had the 7 vials full of the 7 last plagues, and talked with me, saying, come hither, I will show thee the bride, the Lamb's wife. Now, just to clarify, guys, that the city is not the wife. The city is the place the wife will be dwelling in. The wife is the bride of Christ. The bride of Christ is the church, the born-again believers in the church age, not part of the denomination, and definitely not part of some vile institution. Those that believe on Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, and Jesus Christ alone, are those that are part of the bride of Christ. They're no longer engaged or espoused or spoken for. Now they're the bride. So we see concerning this heaven, this place to look forward to, we see what is new. New heaven, new earth, and new Jerusalem. We see what's next, but I want you to notice with me this morning, as we begin to look at this place, I want you to see what is nice. Look in verse 10 with me. The Bible says, speaking of this new Jerusalem, they carry me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. It doesn't say that the city landed on earth. Holy Jerusalem, new Jerusalem, same thing. It doesn't say that it landed there, but we could say that it did, because we know, as we'll see a little later on, probably tonight, that those in the new earth will have an opportunity to come in to the new Jerusalem, to take of that water, and then, you know, their dwelling places on the earth. But we'll get into that later. Don't get distracted by that now. Beloved, we find the size of this place is 12,000 furlongs in each direction. It's shaped like two pyramids, if you will, that would be connected at the base, having eight sides, or 10 if you count the base. The city is made of gold containing jasper, which is carbon, guys, which is the chief constituent of all living things and is transparent. Now, Jesus Christ have already told us in John 14, he says, "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." Amen. Now, let's just make it clear, guys. It says mansions. Let's make that clear. The Bible says mansions, not more than enough room in my Father's home. The Bible says mansion, not many rooms. The Bible says mansions, not many dwelling places. Now, I'll just leave that and let you chew on that for a while. Can I say this to you this morning, that it's high time that the people of Christ begin to tell the truth and get out of reading some watered-down text and get into the Word of God? Beloved, think about it like this. 12,000 furlongs in breadth, height, and width, all right, in all directions within these mansions. That's enough room for 5 million apartments every cubic mile, or 41 trillion rooms, 15 square foot apiece, or 200 trillion rooms, 10 square feet apiece. There's more than 10 rooms for every soul saved who dies between Pentecost and the second coming of Christ, and that's if 100 million Christians die every year. In other words, when you get to heaven, you're going to settle down into a house with at least 10 rooms, each 10 square feet apiece, made out of solid gold. And that's just an estimate of 100 million saved souls dying every year since Pentecost, which, to be honest with you, is a quite large of an estimate, especially when we consider the pseudo-Christian groups deceiving millions today. Plus, you have to factor in the amount of babies that have went on before us, which will probably equal the same amount of saved adults. God has a funny way of doing things like that. Now, guys, I just wanted to give you a little bit of a taste this morning of what is heaven, something to look forward to in our life. A place that is beyond our idea. This place called Holy Jerusalem. This place called New Jerusalem. The dwelling place for the saved on earth. Beloved, a place, Holy Jerusalem, has no sewer, no landfill, no politicians, no COVID-19, no traffic lights, no lockdown, no snowflakes, no terrorists, no heartaches, no pain. A place that we get to look forward to, no matter how dark and how dismal it gets in this world today. There's nothing compared to what lies before us today. A place that's new. The Bible tells me that there's nothing new under the sun. Well, praise God that we don't need a sun in the new Jerusalem, because there's something new up there. Amen. There's going to be a new earth, and there's going to be a new heaven. We'll get into those aspects tonight, of those three branches of folk that are living in eternity. We'll get into those this evening. But I just want to give you this thought today, this consideration, to get your eyes on what is above. I personally do not believe that we can mentally fathom how nice and how beautiful it's going to be. Hey, artists have tried, they've done their best, and they've done a great and wonderful job in trying to depict what this new Jerusalem is going to be like, what our dwelling place is going to be like. But honestly, we have not the mind of God. He said, "My ways are not thy ways, my thoughts are not thy thoughts." The thoughts of God are higher than our thoughts. The ways of God are higher than our ways. So, no, I don't really believe that we can fully comprehend what it's truly going to be like in this new Jerusalem, what it's truly going to be like on the other side of glory. But I think we can get a little bit of a taste this morning. I think we can get a little bit of a taste that gives us something to look forward to. I hope and pray that God has blessed your heart with this. I look forward to this evening as we pick up where we left off in Revelation 21 and we begin to look forward to that place. And I just encourage you with this thought, and I'm done this morning. Take your eyes off what's going on here. I believe if we get our heart and our eyes a little more vertical and a little less horizontal, we'll get a slight little glimpse of what God has in store for us. You're not going to see it this side of glory. You're not going to experience this side of glory. But you can prepare for that cross, that walking across that river. We can go over there. Stonewall Jackson said, "Let us cross over the river and rest under the shade tree." So today, my friend, let's start thinking about New Jerusalem. Let's start thinking about that heavenly abode that every Christian, every believer has. Let's get our eyes and our mind off of what this world has to offer. And let's look at what God has prepared. Father in heaven, I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity this morning. I pray, Lord, that you would, in a great way, bless every soul that hears this message. Pray, dear God, that you'd lead us in the way that bring honor and glory to your name. And I pray, Father, as we begin to look considerably at what you have prepared for us on high, that we would ever be so thankful to live in this age. Lord, I pray for those who have had opportunity to be saved and have yet to make that full confession. I ask you, Lord, that you move upon their soul today. There are loads of distractions. And so many people out there today are just not, they're not focused on who and what you are. They're being moved. They're being twisted. They're being turned. They're being deceived. Father, I pray that you give a little light. Lord, help us connect the dots tonight as we look at part two of heaven, something to look forward to. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, turn over to Brother Preston this morning for the final hymn of the day. I do want to thank you again for being here. I'll have some closing remarks after our final hymn this morning. Brother Preston. Praise the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. I hope and pray you guys had a blessed morning this morning. I want to remind you guys, we are back again tonight at 5:30. So at 5:30, we'll be back for part two of today's message, Heaven, Something to Look Forward to. So guys, join us back tonight live on Facebook and live on YouTube. for our second part of this message and for our second worship service of the day, our PM worship service. And remember, we are back live together next week at 11 a.m. We'll be doing one service on Sunday for an indefinite period of time until things kind of play out and we see what the next step we can be taking. We will be evaluating things on a weekly basis, and we will be notifying everyone as early as possible. So for the just as a reminder, for the rest of this month, for the July, we will be going two services on Wednesday. They will be virtual at the present moment, and we'll be starting next week live in person at 11 a.m., and then we'll continue to move forward and evaluate things on a weekly basis, keeping everyone informed. Guys, have yourself a wonderful and blessed rest of your Sunday afternoon. See you back together tonight at 5:30. Brother Preston, be so kind, dismiss us in prayer.
Your Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be here. Thank you for the good message. God, I pray that we'll just put our focus upon where we're going, not what's going on. Yes. And God, that we can just remain joy-filled in serving you, Lord, with all fervency, Lord. I pray that you'll just be with us throughout the remainder of this day. I ask that you'll just help Brother Stagner as he prepares for this evening. In Jesus' name, amen.
See you later.